We all have a story, right? We all have a story about what God's done in our life. We all have a story about how Jesus has changed our life. And probably if you're here today, hopefully you have a story about how this church has changed your life. And so if you have a story like that that you'd like to share with us, you can send that to mystory@bombbaptist.com. And so we have a few of those coming in, and they're very encouraging, and I hope that you will send one too. One last thing before we get into the message, I promise. Last housekeeping thing, and we will talk about Jesus. Next week is Palm Sunday, and then the week after that will be Easter Sunday. And first off, we hope that all of you are here, but we also hope that all of you bring a friend. Here's what we're doing for the next 2 weeks. Everybody who is here is going to bring a friend to church with them in the next 2 weeks. And so everybody bring somebody, whether you're old, young, or somewhere in between. We want everybody to bring somebody, because in this Easter season, people are open to coming to church. This is one of the best opportunities that we have as a church to bring people in, because during these 2 weeks, people will come to church if you ask them. People want to find a place to go to church on Easter, and they want to talk about Jesus during this season. So by all means, if you have to buy their lunch, if you have to pay them money, if you have to, whatever you have to do to get people to come to church with you, by all means, bring them to church. And I promise you to preach a message that if they are a lost person, they will understand how to be saved. I promise you that over the next couple weeks. And so hope that you bring somebody with you next week. And with that being said, we're going to get into the message. And so if you have your Bible, you can turn to John 21. And it's going to be a few minutes before we get there to actually read. But before we get to John 21, I want to pray, and then we will kind of talk about some of the background that we need to get where we're going today. And so if you would you pray with me this morning? Father, we thank you for who you are and what you've done for us. Father, we thank you for Jesus and the cross. And Father, we ask in this moment that as we read your word and we talk about you, that you'd allow your Holy Spirit to open our eyes and our hearts so that we can understand what's being said. Father, these people, they do not need to hear a word from me. They don't need my opinion. But Father, I pray that today in this moment that they would hear your word, a word from you, because that is what they really need. Father, we ask that you would do miracles in this moment, that you would change hearts and lives, and that it would be all to your glory. And it's through Jesus we pray. Amen. And so today we're going to be talking about the disciple named Peter, and his actual name was Simon Peter. And I love talking about Simon Peter because Simon Peter is relatable. He's relatable. He has plenty of problems. And if you're like me, you like to read about people in the Bible who have problems because it kind of gives you hope that if God could use such a numbskull as Peter, maybe he can do something with me too. And so Peter is a guy who has a lot of problems. He has a lot of issues. And the first time that we see Peter in Scripture, he's in a boat with his brother and his dad, and they haven't caught anything. They fished all night, and they've kind of give up for the day. And Jesus comes by, and he says, "Hey, boys, have you caught anything?" And they say, "No, we've not caught anything." And Jesus says, "Well, could I give you some fishing advice?" And of course, they say, "Well, you're a carpenter." But they allow Jesus to give them some fishing advice to throw their nets on the other side. And they almost sink the ship with all of the fish that they catch. And so shortly after that, Jesus would ask Peter and his brother to come and follow him. And they do. They decide to leave the family business. They decide to leave their father's house and go and follow Jesus. And as Peter walked and talked with Jesus, he would become one of Jesus' closest friends. He was in Jesus' inner circle. And one time, Jesus had sent his disciples out into a storm Because sometimes God will allow you to go through storms so that your faith will be built. But Jesus sends His disciples out into a storm, and things are getting bad, and the wind's starting to blow, and the waves are starting to pick up, and all of a sudden the disciples see this man walking across the top of the water. And I know none of you are amazed by that because you've heard it all of your life, but I said that He was walking on top of the water. Jesus was like, I want to see you do that because you don't seem impressed. I said Jesus was on top of the water walking. And the disciples are impressed by that. I guess they were easier to impress than you guys maybe. But Peter says, I want to do that. I want to do that. Call me out on the water. If you are God, call me out on the water. And so Jesus says, come here then. And Peter starts walking out on the water, but he takes his eyes off of Jesus and he falls down into the water. And just in the nick of time, Jesus catches Peter. Peter, over the time that he walks with Jesus, would have seen countless miracles. He would have seen Jesus heal the sick, raise the dead, multiply the fish and the loaves. And in my opinion, if anybody was close to Jesus, Peter was close to Jesus. If anybody knew the power that Jesus healed, it was Peter. If anybody knew who Jesus was or what His heart was, it would have been Peter. And on the night right before Jesus was betrayed, He was in this upper room having dinner with His friends, His disciples, and He says, hey guys, I want to tell you something. Tonight, I'm going to be arrested. I'm going to be arrested because one of you will lead the Jewish leaders to me. One of you will betray me, and I'll ultimately be crucified on the cross. And as soon as Peter hears this, he jumps up and he says, Lord, it's not me. Lord, it's not me. I would never do that. I had rather die than betray you. And Jesus, you know, He appreciates that zeal, but He looks at Peter in His eyes with love and He says, Peter, before the rooster crows in the morning, you will deny me three times. Peter says, no, that's ridiculous. I would never deny you, Jesus. Later that night, the disciples would be in the Garden of Gethsemane with Jesus, and some of them would be asleep, and Jesus would be praying. But they see the mob coming to arrest Jesus, and they're led by Judas. And as they come and they approach Jesus, Peter pulls out his sword, and he wants to cut off the head of this man who's coming to arrest Jesus, but he misses and cuts off his ear. And Jesus stops Peter and says, no, you don't understand what's going on here. You don't understand what's happening. This is not how my kingdom will be established. And so Jesus picks up the ear and he just puts it right back on the guy. So Peter had seen the power that Jesus has. And they arrest Jesus and they take him into the court of the high priest, and all of the disciples except Peter and John scatter. They all go different directions, but John and Peter go into the court of the high priest, and somehow they get separated, and Peter is beside of a fire trying to get warm. And the Bible records that there was this young girl, probably a middle school girl, and she says, hey, I know you from somewhere, talking to Peter. He's like, no, you don't know me from anywhere. She says, yeah, I know you. You were with that man they just arrested. You were with him. I seen you with that man. And he said, no, you got it all wrong. I don't even know that man. And so she buys his story, and he goes on a little longer, and there's another man who approaches him, and he says, hey, I know you. You were with that Nazarite. You were with Jesus, that man they just arrested. And Peter says, no. You've got it wrong. I don't even know Jesus. I don't even know Jesus. What are you talking about? And then later that night, they're talking about crucifixion for Jesus. And so surely his disciples, if they were caught, would be crucified as well. And somebody says, "Aren't you one of Jesus' disciples?" And he curses at the man and he says, "I do not know that man." And just as he does that, the rooster crows and his mind goes back to what Jesus had said earlier that night, that he would deny him three times before the rooster crowed. Later that night, or earlier that morning, I guess, they would crucify Jesus. They would beat him and beyond all recognition, mutilate his body. And Peter, who was his best friend, was nowhere to be found. Nowhere to be found. Peter had run away from his best friend, Jesus, in his greatest hour of need. Jesus would be buried, and Peter would not see Jesus until the morning of the resurrection. He runs to the grave, and he sees Jesus, and then just a couple days after that is when we pick up in our story. And I can only imagine the weight of the emotion that Peter must have been under this particular morning. Not only did he deny a friend, not only did he deny knowing Jesus while he was dying in his greatest hour of need, but it turns out that after Jesus died, he came back to life. And so he hadn't just denied a good friend or a miracle worker, but he had denied the very Son of God. Could you imagine how Peter felt? He had made the biggest mistake of his life. He had denied a friend, but he'd also denied God himself. And I can just imagine that the weight of his failure was weighing down on Peter this particular morning. All of the wrong choices that he had made were playing through his head. All of the things that had happened the past few days were just playing in his head. And he probably realized at this point that he had denied the very Savior of the world. He was probably thinking about all the missed opportunities that his mistakes had cost him. He was probably staring depression right in the eye when we pick up in our story. I could only imagine how Peter felt this morning. He probably felt like he had gone too far, he had done too much. Can you identify with Peter? Have you ever made a mistake in your life and somebody found out, or everybody found out, and you just thought, there's no way I'll ever get past this mistake. There's no way I could ever get beyond this failure. There's no way that I've done some stupid things in my life, but this particular thing tops them all. Have you ever made a mistake like that? That's how Peter was feeling on this morning. And I bet you that Peter on this particular morning thought that his failure was final. I want us to take a look at John 21. Starting in verse 1. It says, "After this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he revealed himself in this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. And Simon Peter said to them, 'I am going fishing.' They said to him, 'We will go with you.' They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to them, 'Children, do you have any fish?' They answered him, 'No.' And he said to them, 'Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some.' And so they cast it, and now they were not able to haul in because of the quantity of fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved, therefore, said to Peter, 'It is the Lord.' And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea. The other disciples came in on the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from land, but only about 100 yards. But when they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire in place, and they with fish laid out and bread. And Jesus said to them, "Bring some fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And although they were many, the net was not torn. And Jesus said to them, "Come and have some breakfast." I love Jesus. "Come and have some breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. And Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. And this was the third time Jesus was revealed to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" And he said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And he said to him, "Feed my sheep." He said to him a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And he said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And he said to him, "Tend my sheep." And he said to him a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." And then in verse 19, "And after saying these things, he said to him, follow me." On this particular day, the disciples had already seen Jesus and he'd already been resurrected. But Peter is down and out, and he's to the point where he says, "I'm going fishing. I'm going back to the thing that Jesus brought me out of." He was a fisherman before Jesus said to follow him. And he was going back to fishing now that Jesus was, now that he had failed Jesus. He felt like there was no way that he could keep following Jesus with the failure that had just happened in his life. Did you know that sometimes the enemy will tempt you to go back to the place where Jesus brought you out of when you fall? Sometimes the enemy will catch you while you're down, and he will say, "Why don't you just stay down here a while? Why don't you just hang out here at the bottom for a while? While you're down, just go back to what Jesus brought you out of." But Peter goes out, and the disciples, they didn't have much willpower either, so they just went with Peter. And they go out and they're trying to catch some fish, but they can't catch any. And so Peter's thinking, I fail the Son of God, and now I'm failing at fishing. The thing that I grew up doing, I can no longer do. I am just a failure. And then a familiar scene unfolds for Peter. There's a man standing on the shore and he says, "Cast your net on the right side of the boat." It's almost as if Jesus is saying, "Peter, don't you remember what I've taught you? Don't you remember what side to throw the net on if you want to catch fish? Don't you remember what I told you just 3 years ago?" And when they heard that, they knew it was the Lord. They had heard that before. And so Peter just jumps into the ocean and starts swimming. He knows that he has to get to Jesus. And I'm sure that Peter probably thought that Jesus was going to reprimand him, that Jesus was probably going to say something mean to him, that he was going to fuss at him for failing him. But when the disciples come up on the shore, they don't find a Jesus that is angry. They don't find a Jesus that is mad. They don't find a Jesus who is upset. They find a Jesus who has cooked breakfast. They have all just deserted him. Peter has denied him three times, and Jesus has cooked breakfast. Jesus has cooked breakfast. He had the very thing they were looking for in the ocean already on the shore ready for them. They had went out in the ocean looking for something. They had went back to their old way of life to look for something. But Jesus already had fish ready to cook on the shore waiting on them. Jesus just wanted them to know that they couldn't get what they needed from their old way of life. Jesus just wanted them to know that they couldn't go back to that thing that He had brought them out of and find any satisfaction. Did you know that you can't go back to the things you used to do once you started following Jesus and find the same satisfaction that you once did? You can't go back to the things where if you were a drug dealer or if you used drugs, you can't get the same satisfaction out of drugs when you become a Jesus follower. There's just something that happens. If you were addicted to something else, if you were addicted to sex or pornography, you can't get that same kind of satisfaction once you become a believer. Something changes in your heart and you become miserable doing the things that you once enjoyed doing. And so, Jesus had the very thing that they were looking for already prepared for them on the shore. And after they eat breakfast, Jesus pulls Peter to the side and He says, "Peter, do you love Me?" Peter said, "Yes, Lord, I love You." And then He says, "Feed My sheep. Feed My sheep." And then He says, "Peter, do you love Me?" And Peter says, "Yes, Lord, I love You. I love You. You know that I love You." And He says, "Feed My sheep." And then He says, "Peter, do you love Me?" And Peter's a little offended. He says, "Yes, Lord, of course I love You. You know everything. Of course I love You." And then He says, "Feed My sheep." Do you know what I believe that Jesus was doing in this moment? He was giving Peter back his purpose. He was saying, "I know you've failed. I know you've made a mistake. In fact, you made three big mistakes. You denied Me three times, but I'm going to give you a purpose back. I'm going to give you a purpose even after you've failed, even after you've made a mistake. I want you to know that I can still use you, that I can still leverage what you have. I can still use the things that I've given you. You've not gone too far or done too much for Me to use you. And if you will, you can feed My sheep." Jesus is saying, "I still have a plan for your life. I know you've made mistakes, but I still love you." And you know, I don't know what you've done over the last week or the last month, or I don't know what you've been through, and you know, I really don't need to know that. But I don't know what failure you've experienced, but I came to encourage you in this light today. Your failure is not final. Your failure is not final. You see, so many times the enemy, when we failed, he starts lying to us and he says, you know, "The Lord could never use you because of that. The Lord could never use you because you went through that. The Lord could never, He would never have you. He would never love you after you've done those things." Do you know what I'm talking about? Can anybody identify? He starts lying to you and he says, "You know, God could never have a purpose for you. If people knew what you'd done, they'd never listen to you when you told them about Jesus. If you told people what had happened to you, they'd think you was lying because of what you used to do." And the thing about it is that that's all a lie. We've never gone too far for God to use us. We've never gone too far for God to love us. Your failure is not final. The enemy will tell you that you're done, that you're finished, that it's over with, but your failure is not final. You may have messed up, and you may have really done it this time. You may have messed up big time. You may have fell back into that old familiar habit, that old familiar addiction. But your failure does not have to define you. Your failure does not have to define you. Whatever you've done, whatever it was, you don't have to sit down and sulk about your failures. But you can rise above all of your failures in victory. When Peter denied the Lord, he denied Him three times. And three times God gave him his purpose back. Every time that he denied Him, God gave him his purpose back. Three times. It was significant because for every time Peter denied Him, Jesus gave him purpose back in his life. The enemy tries to convince us that God is mad at us because of the mistakes we've made. Peter would have thought that Jesus would have been mad on this particular morning, but Jesus was not mad. He cooked breakfast. Have you ever cooked breakfast for anybody that you were mad at? Some of you wives may have, but I never have. Jesus cooks these boys breakfast because He is not mad at them. He is not mad at what they've done. He just wants them to come back to Him. You've not gone too far for the love of God to stop pursuing you. You may have thought that God stopped loving you a long time ago. You may have thought that God stopped caring about you in your life a long time ago. But you have not gone so far that the love of God has stopped pursuing you. You can't be so bad that God could never use you. Your failure is not final. There is hope for your future. So let me share this with you. In Romans 3:23, the Bible says that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Do you know what it means to sin? It's an archery term, and it means literally to miss the mark. The mark is Jesus. Okay, so the mark is hard to hit. The mark is hard to hit, and so sin could be defined that anything you do that falls short of Jesus can be qualified as sin. Has anybody sinned today? Anybody falling short of Jesus and His perfect plan? Everything we do that is not just like Jesus is sinful. And as long as we have these flesh suits on, as long as we have these sinful bodies, we're going to have a tendency to do wrong. We're going to have a tendency to fail. But let me make this clear. No matter how you have failed, God's grace is sufficient for you. God's grace is sufficient for you. Grace is not a license to sin. Grace is a license to get back up. Grace is not a license to sin. You can't just do whatever you want to in grace. But grace is the thing that says no matter how many times you've fallen, no matter how bad you've been, no matter what you've done, you can still get up because of God's grace. Grace will be sufficient for you. When you've failed and when you're falling, instead of having a pity party for yourself, does anybody else do that but me? I do that all the time. When I've fallen, when I've failed, I want to have a pity party. I want somebody to come and feel sorry with me. But grace says that in that moment when we're feeling sorry for ourselves, we can rise above our sin by the grace of God. Proverbs 24:16 says this: though a righteous man falls seven times, he will get back up. But the wicked, when they stumble, into ruin. You know the difference between a wicked person and a righteous person? A wicked person, when they fall, they don't have the strength to get back up. When they fall, they just stay in whatever they fell in. When they fall, there's nothing that says in them, get back up out of this. But a righteous person always gets back up. Righteousness is not about how many times you fall. It's about how many times you get back up. As believers in Jesus Christ, we have the Holy Spirit living inside of us, and He will guide us to get back up every time we fall. He will guide us to get back up out of the thing that we're in and start walking towards Jesus again. For every failure in your life, there's a comeback. That's what this series that we're in right now, the comeback story, is all about. It's about that every time you fall, every time you fail, every time you experience a storm in your life, it's a setup for a comeback. And so your failures are setting you up to come back to something glorious. The Holy Spirit does not allow us to stay in our defeat, but the Holy Spirit gives us strength to get back up in our darkest hour. I want you to look at your neighbor, and I want you to tell them, your failure is not final. Now look at your other neighbor, the second choice, and tell them, your failure is not final. Now tell them, get back up. Get back up. Get back up. Your failure is not final. Get up, this thing is not going to destroy you. You may be down and out today, you may be discouraged, but I want you to know that this thing will not destroy you. This thing will not overcome you. This thing is not strong enough to break God's love in your life. I believe that you hold the decision of whether to get back up or to stay down. When you fall, when you fail, you have a decision to make. You can decide to stay down there, and you can decide to have a pity party. You can decide to fail and to just stay where you are. Or you can decide to get back up and start your comeback story. Yes, I fell. Yes, I failed. Yes, I have some problems. And yes, I'm still struggling. Yes, I've not got it all figured out. But I want you to know that I'm coming back. I'm coming back. I fell and I fell right on my face, but I'm coming back. I'm coming back. Look at somebody and say, I'm coming back. I'm coming back. It starts today. Your comeback can start today. Some of you believe that you're too bad for God to use you. I was thinking about this morning, and I just wanted to give you some encouragement. Did you know that Moses killed a man before God used him to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt? Did you know that Abraham was a liar, but God still used him to be the father of many nations? Did you know that Samson was a womanizer, David was a murderer and an adulterer? Did you know that Peter denied Jesus 3 times and he still started the early church? On the day of Pentecost, Peter would preach just 40 days after what we're talking about. Peter would preach and 3,000 people would come to Christ. Just a few days after the worst failure of his life would come, the greatest days of his life, Paul killed Christians for a living before God used him to write more than half of the New Testament. Failure will come. You will fall and you will fail. But I want you to know that you can come back from any failure. You can come back from any disappointment. You can come back from whatever has happened, whether you've been a Christian for 40 years or for 40 minutes, you will fail. But when you fail, it is not final. It is not over with. You can keep going. You can keep pushing on. by the grace of God, you can move forward with your life. By the grace of God, you can push on and come back. Did you know that today you can push on because of the cross? Do you realize that every one of your fears, every one of your failures, every one of your mistakes has already been nailed on the cross of Calvary? Do you realize that the thing that you've been struggling with, the thing that has been weighing you down, the thing that has been trying to destroy you, has already been dealt with at Calvary? It has already been dealt with at Calvary. Do you realize that the mistake you've been kicking yourself over this week was already paid for at Calvary before you ever committed it? Do you realize that the mistake that you will make this week that's going to try to get you down and keep you down has already been paid for at Calvary? It has already been paid for. Every single mistake, every single failure, it was all nailed to Jesus on that day. Jesus died that day, but 3 days later, He would come back. He would come back. Jesus was crucified on the cross. And you know, the enemy thought that they had won. The enemy thought that things were going according to his plan. And when Jesus died, the enemy thought he had won the battle. He thought he had won the battle, and he thought, all of these people for the rest of eternity, they're going to be mine. I can have control. I can decide what happens in their life. But 3 days later, the enemy got a rude awakening. When Jesus came out of that grave, the enemy was defeated on that day. Jesus rose victorious over your fears, over your mistakes, over your failures, over everything in your life that's been keeping you held down. And did you know that anything that Jesus conquered at the cross, you can conquer today? If you believe this message about Jesus, if you've given Him your life, everything that Jesus conquered, you can conquer. Everything that Jesus was victorious over, you can be victorious over. No sin, no fear, no death has to hold you down or hold you back. We can stand up and keep going. Because Jesus did not stay down. Because Jesus did not stay down, you don't stay down. Because Jesus didn't lay down when everybody thought that He had failed, you don't stay down. But you can come back and rise in victory over everything in your life. Because Jesus is alive, you are alive. Because Jesus won, you can win. He is our victory. Failure is not final. And I believe that that's something to praise Him about. The praise team's just about to come, and I want to pray for you as they come. Listen, I realize that on a morning like this, as many people's in this room, there are so many different things going on in your life. I realize that there's people here who think you've gone too far or done too much. There's people here who maybe your marriage is on the rocks. There's people here who have sick children and have sick loved ones. And I realize that there is a million things going on in this moment. And I just want to take a moment and pray for you. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what's going on in your life. But I do realize that in this moment, Jesus can change everything. In this moment, everything can change with Jesus. And so, they're going to start playing. And I just want to pray in this moment for you and your family and your situation. And so, Father, we come to You right now. And Lord, in a room this size, God, there's so many things going on, Father. And what's great about you is that even right now, you can look into every one of our lives and every one of our situations and you can see exactly what we need. Father, you can see right now in this moment what the cry of our hearts are. God, you can see right now in this moment exactly what we really need. And so, God, we pray right now you would begin to do miracles in our life. Father, you said we have not because we ask not. And so in this moment, we want to ask you to do miraculous things in our life. Father, we know people who need to be healed. Father, bodies that need to be touched. Marriages that need to be healed. Father, kids who are far off from Jesus that need to be brought close. Father, I pray that whatever is needed in this moment, God, that you would provide. God, that you would be sufficient in that moment. God, in all of these people's lives, God, we all need you. God, we all have need. And God, we ask you to begin moving in this moment, God. Lord, we need you. God, I pray in this moment, if there be anybody who isn't saved, God, who doesn't know you, who hasn't have a relationship with you, God, I pray that could begin right now. God, let that start right now. Let them decide to follow you for the rest of their lives. God, we need you in this moment. God, you do your work. You do a miracle in this moment. And we'll praise you for it. We love you and we thank you. And it's through Jesus we pray. Amen. Right now, I'm going to invite you to stand up. And as you do, could we just give God a hand clap for all that He's doing in our church? Listen, the altar's going to be open. If you need to talk to somebody, if you need to pray about something going on in your life, I would love to talk and pray with you. And there's some other people who will be here who can do that as well.